somewhere.
All right, everyone. I want to just say thank you again to Virginia. She got us off to a wonderful start. Thank you, Virginia, for your introduction to the remarkable legacy here in Milwaukee. So we heard a bit about the history. We're now going to turn to a panel that's going to discuss the question, public parks, why our history matters. We are delighted to have three individuals from three different academic institutions here with us. And we are also delighted to have Emma Rudd, who heads up the Milwaukee Preservation Alliance, serving as our moderator. We look forward to this discussion. And in every one of our panel presentations, we will have time for audience Q&A. So get your pens ready. If you hear something you want to ask about, you will have the opportunity. So Emma, with that, thank you so much.
All right. Make sure, can everyone hear? All right. Well, thank you so much to our wonderful panelists for joining us today. I think we're all excited for a wonderful conversation. Again, thank you to Dee Dee and to Virginia for the opportunity to speak today. I know Olmsted means a lot to us, and I'm very excited to kind of dive right into our questions. So our first question for the panelists is, why do Olmsted's work and ideas, I know we talked a lot about shelter, shade, prospect, comfort, his parks are for all people, why do you think they still matter today? There is not an order. Whoever wants to, you go right ahead.
Sure, I can start it off. So thank you for having us today. And I like the idea of focusing on the ideas. I think often when I talk about Olmsted to people, the image that we've often seen of him looking almost like a bald Santa Claus comes up, and like people get locked in, like this guy's gonna talk to me about this ancient person, and it's sort of locked in a Ziploc bag. But I wanna make the argument that the ideas that fueled his work were radical, and not only for that moment, but into the contemporary moment. And so I would start with, and Virginia did a great job of, I think, setting this up, the idea of what he saw in the Cotton Kingdom was, first and foremost, a condemnation of the horrific institution of slavery, but also the spatial sort of representation of that system. And so he saw these elite plantation owners, slaveholders, with these wonderful gardens, these libraries, these things that were incredible resources for them, but only for them. But the rest of Southern society did not have access to such spaces. And this harmed, obviously, not only the slaves, but also non-slaveholding white people. And so the idea of wanting to have, as Virginia suggested, parks for all people, meaning they were accessible to all people. And that's one thing, but also the idea that these become democratic spaces, not only because they are indeed accessible, but because they sort of allow you to become a citizen. Olmsted understood that if you bring people together, they have to get together and figure it out. And then as they do that, these spaces became places where you could sort of call for your rights or use them as places where you can call for greater citizenship. So when I was working on something for the exhibition that Anne Marie Sawkins put together, I found this wonderful image of a sort of right after Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated, people from the civil rights movement in Milwaukee gathered in Washington Park. And then and then fast forward to 2020, when there's these moments of protests following the murder of George Floyd, people gathered in Washington Park. And it was just sort of this understanding that this space is a space for citizenship and a place to call for greater rights. And so I think that I'll leave it there because I don't want to. Yeah, so that's kind of where I would start this conversation, if for me.
Thank you again for coming, and thanks for inviting me to this panel. I think I'm going to actually bring something that a philosopher that has impacted my work, Hannah Arendt, and she has really talked about public space as something that binds us together, and we all know that our country, the world, is extremely divided. We are isolated, we are segregated, different kind of segregation, but it's still we are segregated, we don't talk to each other. And Hannah Arendt, when she was talking about creating the commons, the public, talks about, she produces a metaphor for public space. It's like the table that we share between us, and this the table connects us. It's something we share. At the same time, I look at the people around the table and I know that's not me, that's difference. So I feel like Olmsted's designs and parks offer us that table that we share, both in terms of green space, leisure space, but also in terms of history, good and bad. I was looking at some of the design features of Olmsted. The first one has to do with movement. He sequences movement and lets people see each other. That's literally an act of seeing. He's teaching us how to see the world that we share, but also people who share the world with us as others, is not something somebody who's just like us. The other one, which was very important and I felt was kind of valid, was the genus loci, the genius of place, the specificity of Washington Park, the specificity of Lake Park, and that is literally talking about what we share. So I've been working on Washington Park for a while in the neighborhood, and I do know that two sides of Washington Park is divided, the two sides are divided, not just with a major street going through it, but through economics, race, housing characteristics, and so on. So we do share that division. I'm talking about something that we do not want to talk about. We do share the division between black and white, rich and poor, and Washington Park sits in the middle. And therefore, Washington Park actually allows us to see that not so good history that we share. And it also gives us that opportunity to bring those histories together. So I feel like talking about Olmsted's values really helps us understand how we can come together as people, but not across people who understand that we have differences, to how to talk across differences rather than by removing differences.
Thank you. I think I'm on. Good morning, everybody. Again, it's a pleasure to be here, honored to be a part of the panel. I guess really the most profound thing about Frederick Olmsted for me is really its activism in real time, as far as literally cultivating the landscape to embrace all who walk across the grounds. And so even in the limited research I did do of him, the idea that he was very much about humanity, the fact that he was an abolitionist, and his philosophies, and then also the idea that, again, making the park accessible to everybody. So the idea that there is that division, there is that perception, and I think a lot of what's going on as far as the community in this particular area, it's been about redefining whatever those negative perceptions might be, regardless of people's background, regardless of people's political affiliations, regardless of people's economic standing. And even in the few years I've had the opportunity to be on the Bandshell Committee, it speaks for itself in the programming of the park. It's literally continuing to bring people together. And so I think that's really the most profound aspect, is that it's activism in real time as far as cultivating the earth, right? To bring people together. And I think a lot of people miss that because they just pass it by as just another park of some sort. But I think what's great about Olmsted is that he walked the walk, he talked the talk, and his aesthetic spoke to that.
Thank you, that's wonderful. So in that thread, so I know we talk about how Olmsted's parks in Milwaukee kind of bring people together, and you know, we could argue that they're very locally activated, but when you talk about Olmsted, everyone's mind immediately goes to Central Park, it goes to Biltmore. So how can we raise kind of the profile of our historic parks so that more of a national attention and start to bring in tourists to appreciate the parks as we do?
I mean, I think through events like this, I think through intentional outreach. I've been in Washington Park and talked to folks who will, and sort of informally talking to users of the park through classes that I teach. And when I talk to people about why they like the park, they'll inevitably talk about some of the features that Olmsted put into the park. But yet they don't know that. And as Virginia suggested, that was by design, this idea that you should think that this is just the way it was. And so I think making those connections, and honestly, for a park like Washington Park, the historical designation status, Washington Park does not have that. And also, and that's sometimes an issue because people think, again, kind of going back to this idea of Olmsted is locked in the past, that if you give something historic designation, that you can't touch it, that it becomes, this thing that is just not usable anymore. Central Park has historic designation status. I was in New York this past summer, and people were using the park in a variety of ways. It did in no way limit that, but it draws attention to that value. And then I think through that, you can start to hone in on the ideas why this is so historically important.
I think there are two things that you asked. One was, how do you raise the profile, and how can we attract tourists? And I think that's slightly different, two different things. The raising the profile part is actually more interesting to me. Raising the profile within Milwaukee. Once we know that we have a treasure, others will come. And in terms of raising the profile, I feel the most important thing for all of us in this room to do is education. We have to educate people in ways of seeing, which is what he talked about, and about the heritage that we share. And the parks can well become a place where such things happen. There are things happening already. There are health-related events where we talk about shared wellness. We have schools coming in. We teach about the heritage of Washington Park to schools. We have heritage walks, which I found was a very important way of actually bringing neighbors, communities around and talk about the history. So just having a park is not going to make it work. You have to teach people the value of seeing and being in the park. And in terms of being the bringing in tourists, I think it's the same thing. But I feel the notion of stewardship is, and what it means, should be really taught to our young generations. If intergenerational communication and us as elders cannot teach the young people what we have learned to value, then we are not going to have a park. Sorry.
Yeah, ditto to all of that that was just said. I think innovative programming, much like you said, what's already going on. I mean, I learned about Frederick Olmsted through a walk with Miss Virginia Small. So, you know, I'm a direct recipient of that benefit. But I also think in terms of whether you want to call it grounding or wellness, you know, being able to walk barefoot in the grass, you know, this is not a rural area. And so I think raising the awareness of the magic that the park can provide as far as health. You know, I think a lot of people kind of overlook that, you know, and sometimes green spaces are often neglected or unappreciated because it's just something you drive through to get to the next brick and mortar destination. And so I think as long as there's innovative programming that's consistent, that's servicing to all people, and that people can be made aware of it, that's good. And like you said, you know, tourism, when people come to the city, this is the Third Coast, make no mistake about it. People are flocking from New York and LA to come to the fresh water source of the Midwest. And so we are right between Detroit and Chicago. And so some people call Milwaukee a big suburb of Chicago or whatever, right? So I think being in the main vein of travel, being on a Great Lake, it can't do anything but draw people in and benefit the residents.
So I'm going to throw an audible at you that wasn't on the question list. So I know we mentioned the National Register and that Lake Park is designated, Washington Park is not. So were Washington Park to achieve that designation, how do you feel we could best proceed with the balance of, you know, paying homage to Olmsted and protecting those natural resources while also moving the park into the future? Give you time to think.
I'll tell you my part of the story. I think the way to get it to National Register is to make a case of what this park means to the memory of people who lived around the park. In addition to Olmsted's history, in addition to the history of Milwaukee, this park has memories for people who lived on both sides of Washington Park. So if you look at Washington Park, the neighborhood, the more African American, the less the housing stock is not good, Martin Drive East, it does mean a lot of stuff. We don't hear those stories. Those stories are not collected of memories of people who grew up in the park, who still use the park, young people who still use the park. So I feel like once we actually tell those stories, in addition to the stories of the German past, the immigrant past, and so on, we will have a groundswell of people who are actually seeing this as heritage, not just few people seeing this as heritage. And that makes a claim to national historic preservation as a designated, nationally designated space.
I guess I don't know how to expand much more on that. You know, my mind goes to just soliciting Nicolas Cage to play Frederick Law Olmsted in a film. And then that will put it on everyone's mind on the national stage, right? Because even, you know, I mean, or a play of some sort. I mean, I'm being humorous, but at the same time, I think if you bring light to his life, as far as how that can be depicted, perhaps through the arts, because we already know the arts is the great unifier, and we know that the arts are vibrant in this city, and they're also vibrant in each of the parks, especially Washington Park. So perhaps that is something that could be solicited, whether that's someone writing a short screenplay about his life, or a dramatic reenactment of something significant in his life. Then people start to pay attention.
And I would add, we're not reinventing the wheel here. There's other cities that have done this, and other Olmsted parks where this balance has been achieved, and been achieved in really remarkable ways. So, I mean, I've talked to people in Boston, and so one of the issues with Washington Park is you have a number of actors who all have the park, they want the best for the park. But then this question of, well, how do you balance that? And so you have people that are interested in the history, you have people who are interested, for example, in the programming of the Urban Ecology Center. There's nothing that inherently should put those two people against each other. In Boston, there is a group very similar to the Urban Ecology Center working in Olmsted Parks. Those parks have that same status. And so you can do it. Same in Louisville. And so there's these examples, and it sometimes is a Milwaukee thing that it's almost like we don't want to look at how other people are doing it because we're distinct. People have figured this out. And so if we talk to those people, and that's why I love the fact that this national conference is here in Milwaukee, because I want to hear how other people are doing it because they've done it.
So for my next question. So we talked a lot about, you know, obviously the impact of the park on the surrounding community. How do we ensure, again, not only that the historic landscapes are preserved, you know, but how do we maintain Olmsted's values, and how can we apply that to all of our county parks? I know we've got over 150, you know, parks within this beautiful county, which is very rare for such an urban area. So how do we, not only as citizens, but as advocates, protect and preserve Olmsted's vision?
I guess what was said before, to keep doing what we're doing, that seems like a pretty loaded question there. But I think if right now, with all that's going on with mental illness, all that's going on with healthcare disparities, parks offer healing. It also offers a framework of holistic sort of approaches that can be taken as far as enjoying and being in the park space. So kind of going back to my last comments, you know, I think it gets overlooked, that the healing aspect You know, and I think if that's something that's highlighted, connected to wellness and connected to alternative healing practices, sometimes when you start talking like that, people glaze over because big pharma is the only thing to rely upon, right? But make no mistake about it, parks offer healing to all who enter. And I think if that's something that is showcased and promoted in terms of maybe working with mental health organizations, working with holistic practitioners and things of that nature, that gives a different opportunity of meaning to the purpose behind the parks themselves.
I think it goes back to education. And okay, so Olmsted taught us that parks are for the people. It's public property. We really have forgotten what public means. And I really think there has to be an education. So my generation loves private-public partnership. But the younger generation understands. I teach them, so I know. And when you have public-private partnership and the private partner is the one who calls the shots, then we do not have public space. And it's incumbent of us, those people who don't want to pay taxes or, you know, gets upset when the county raises taxes, that we do, our taxes do make sense, especially if they're used for public good. I know that's not going to happen, but I want to dream of a world, because my students do that too, young people do that too, of a world where we have shared commons. Those are actually supported by the park commission, by the county, who gets money from the state and from the people to actually produce places for the people. And that doesn't say anything against private, public, private partnership. I just feel it should be public and then private partnership.
Yeah, and just to build off of both of those answers, this idea of public in terms of the concept of public health. And so Brad was talking about this idea that you can go to these parks and you feel better. Virginia talked about this idea that during the pandemic, people were going to these parks for a reason, more so than under quote unquote normal circumstances. And so the idea that these are spaces that serve the public health in terms of mental health, but also I think in an era of climate crisis, framing or reframing, and Olmsted understood this. He wasn't using this language, for example, in the 19th century, but he understood that the green spaces in a city had health values for physical health as well as mental health. This is only more glaringly apparent in an era, again, of climate crisis. And so this idea that these become spaces where a city, a municipality can address these concerns, I think is a really interesting way to draw from the Olmstedian past and make it relevant for the present.
Can we also mention friend groups?
Yes. No. I mean, no, we can't mention, no. And I think that is actually a great point. So I know, so Washington Park, Lake Park, you know, we have these friends groups set up in Milwaukee, throughout Milwaukee, that are probably the park's biggest advocates. I would say that anything that gets done in the parks is because of these friends groups. I personally was fortunate enough to work with the Lake Park friends group with the Ravine Road project. And I can tell you that project got done because of that group, you know, because of the advocacy. So I think there is something to be said for the community itself, you know, taking these parks back. You know, I know Arigent mentioned the private-public partnership, and I know the county has mentioned time and time again that they're, you know, in crisis, they're short-staffed, they don't have the funding. So I think this is where our friends groups really come into play, and they're the ones that can really not only rally the immediate community, but the broader community behind the work that they're trying to do. So I don't know if anyone has any comments on that, but yeah.
I just want to actually quickly say something. You must have, in the beginning of when Virginia was talking, you heard the rain, right? And it was a moment which brought back lots of memories to me. So it was raining, but we were not getting wet. In Washington Park and Sherman Park, I work with communities blocks. And when it rains, we run away. And there is no public space to share. Here you have a park where you can want to get wet, get out and go to there. And there are pavilions. So it's a park where there is shelter, but it's actually a public space where people can gather despite rain, despite sunshine. And I love this place because there are no other places like this in the neighborhood in Washington Park and Sherman Park. Few of them, actually.
So that brings up a good point. If money were no object and you could had, you know, no issues getting something done, if you could make one change to the parks or protect one thing, what is something that you would choose?
Any
money is not an object. You can.
Well, I mean, I think for Washington Park, it would be to fix the lagoons. Mm-hmm. I'll leave it. Yeah.
That's fair.
Make them. So they're structural. Oh, sorry. Yeah. There's structural issues with the lagoons. There's maintenance issues with the lagoons. And I should stress, this is not just a Washington Park problem. This is a problem in Milwaukee County parks that have such a feature. And so the fixing and then the maintenance and then the upkeep, making sure that is financed.
So you would suggest following what Homestead has done?
Yeah.
Oh, so the question was if money were no object and you could make it. Oh, her question. She just said
bringing back Olmsted's vision for the lagoons as part of that process.
The Washington Park Bandshell has such a rich history of musicians who have performed on that stage. And right now, I think even though there's quite a bit of live music that takes place throughout the city, we know the lion's share of those high budget performances are down at the fairgrounds where Summerfest is held. But if money were no object, I would say bring some top tier performances to Washington Park that will activate and bring people into that green space. Because, you know, if it's a 95 degree day and you're somewhere where there's trees and grass and you're hearing great music by somebody that, you know, you may have not had an opportunity to see up close like that, you know, that's a different experience than being on miles of asphalt while you sizzle on a hot day, you know. And so when you combine hot asphalt, alcohol, and disgruntled people, you get a different kind of dynamic going on. So if money were no problem at all, I would say activate the park as a premier live music entertainment space and bringing some top tier acts.
Okay, if money was no object, yeah, that's a dream. If money was no object, then put some money back in our public schools, into art education and history education, and get the young people to become stewards and friends of Washington Park. They'll take care of it after that.
I love that. Well, that's it for my questions. Now we're going to hand you over to the room. So if anyone has any questions, feel free. Yes.
I suspect that some of what is happening in a dynamic here, maybe in Washington Park with the Nature Center people versus the Olmsted History Integrity people. And to me, that's always been one of the thorniest problems, is to find the common ground that everybody can live with, so that the Olmsted heritage, however we define that, is respected and enhanced instead of degraded out of sort of partisan politics over parks. So I'd like you all to comment on that if you could.
Yeah, I mean, you're spot on. And when I say it's sort of a coalition of folks, we understood that implicitly. And we began, and this was in 2019, began specifically for Washington Park, bringing together all of these stakeholders for that very reason. There was this lack of understanding of certain, and I think that went on both sides, because I don't claim to be a sort of an urban nature expert, for example. And we started to meet as a group. And then the pandemic hit. We tried to do it on Zoom, but that wasn't the same. And we've tried to pick it up. But when you have this conversation of almost, and this was alluded to, permanent fiscal crisis, that adds a different dimension to those discussions. Because there's a sense that we're willing to entertain anything that keeps this space relevant at all. And that's a hard thing to sit, to have an argument against. And at the same time, if you're on the side that's advocating for that, you understand that that comes with resources. And you see anything that's is a threat to that is something that could cut off those resources. And so it's an interesting dynamic. And we have started to pick up those conversations again, including stakeholders at the county level, the city level, the nonprofit level. And so my hope is that, yeah, we're able to get that ball rolling again.
I think what you just said, most of it, but there's another thing about the park itself, the material object itself. And I'm an architectural historian, so and a cultural landscape historian. So it seems to me what we have to recognize when, you know, Brad was talking about health, how is health operationalized in the context of Lake Park, Washington Park, which is bluffs and lagoons and vistas and paths. So be able to talk about the specificity of the material landscape and what it's doing, not so much about the authorship, which I think is important. History is important, so are ecological issues. But to look at the park itself and then be able to say that this material, particular material landscape has certain wellness benefits, certain benefits of being a democratic society, will actually bring these stakeholders together because that's the common value we share. So I feel like that's one thing you guys are doing already.
Unless I missed it, but I wondered, Brad, if you could speak about your mural that you were inspired to create of Washington Park in Olmsted.
Oh yeah, thank you for that. I was got so caught up in answering the questions. Well, really, I mean, I be honest with you, I'll just give you a little backstory. Myself as a Near West Side artist, partnered with the Near West Side Partners a couple years ago, along in collaboration with Melissa Muller, and curated a mural tour for Valeet Street. And one of the signature pieces that has yet to be placed, but will be placed by next year this time, was the Olmsted mural that's on some of the materials, I guess. But the concept of that mural is Olmsted with the thought balloon, kind of a pop art framework, but within that thought balloon, trying to condense that vast history of the park. From its days as the Milwaukee County Zoo, from its days in Olmsted's time, as well as what's been going on with the programming in the band shell itself in the modern era. So that was a way of condensing the history in a way, and then also having it act as almost like a gateway to the Washington Park area when people would gaze upon it. So the idea of the Westview mural tour was that the walls facing the west, the majority of the walls facing west down Valeet Street between 40th and 27th, all have a mural upon them because the light of the sun will shine upon them for the extent of the day. And so that was the idea behind the tour. But again, the concept of the Olmsted mural, which is called Visions of Olmsted, I'm sure it would do his soul and spirit well to know that it has evolved into the space it's become. And so I think it was just important to encapsulate that history and also bring it to people's awareness who may have not been aware. And sometimes the arts or public art is a good way to make people aware. And hopefully the next phase of that mural tour, which is rooted in either history of the city or something that's culturally relevant to the city. And that was really kind of the root of the mural tour itself. It had to be relevant to the neighborhoods or relevant to the city's history itself. So all that being said, I think the arts and public art are a good way to make people aware. And hopefully a next phase of that will be QR codes that will accompany each of those murals so that there's an interactive aspect that could occur when people engage with the walls. And then if they see that QR code, then they can bring that up on their devices and then be made aware of what that history entails.
Are friends groups considered private?
They're a group of private citizens coming together for a public cause, but that's what our democracy is.
Right, but so for some of the larger financial needs, like fixing the lagoon, if you have campaigns and...
I'm just asking about the concept of large donors contributing to friends groups and how that is not a, I mean, that's a necessity and yet it's a private versus public sponsorship.
I would argue that that's not a sustainable model, that you need public funding to make these parks work. I mean, again, I would never discourage philanthropy or private donations, but that wouldn't necessarily be what I would focus on, if I was a judge. But to tie some of these things together, the way that you can attract often public money is through the historic designation status. So that opens you up to public funding that isn't available. And again, that's I'm not saying that like the private funding, that's the fix. But if you start to think of these things holistically, you can begin to put together the funding that could address some of these glaring problems in these spaces.
And I think just to add on to that, I think our friends groups, like I mentioned previously, are very good at advocating for those public funds. So I think a huge portion of the work that they do, other than soliciting private donations and private fundraisers, is really talking to the powers that be and to try and achieve public funding for their parks and for their projects.
To the point of the public friends groups, and I'm thinking of kind of the grassroots organizing at play, how are friends groups networking with each other to advocate for that kind of power to the people?
Is there anyone from the friends group that would like to answer that? Not to put you on the spot, but go ahead.
From our experience in Milwaukee, the reality, unfortunately, is that friends groups don't work together. There is a nonprofit organization that helps start friends groups, and I believe in the Milwaukee County Park System there are about 35 to 40 friends groups, but there's really no mechanism for them to get together and work together. So that's something that, at least in Milwaukee, we're not doing well, and I think part of it is always because the friends groups are understaffed, right, and underfunded. So if they're working in Brown Deer Park or Grant Park, they've got a billion things to do all the time. And to say, well, and in addition to that, we need to become part of the coalition, it's hard to find volunteers to do that. So it's a challenge, I would say, in any city in the United States to get the various friends groups to work together. So I'll leave that to something for the Olmsted Network to work on.
Can I just follow up for the Washington Park Friends? There has been an individual initiative for a stakeholder or a subject expert that's interested in the lagoon of reaching out to the Humboldt Park Friends for finding out how has that been implemented and how can we replicate those efforts from the Humboldt Park into Washington Park. So it's an individual effort as opposed to a collective strategic plan, I suppose, at this point.
All right, thank you. And we will leave that conversation right there. Unfortunately, we are out of time, but again, I want to thank our panelists, Michael, Brad, Arijit. Thank you so much for coming today, and thank you all for your questions.
Yes, I want to say thank you as well. What a wonderful, provocative conversation, exactly what we want to have today. I think we've heard already themes that we're going to hear in the course of the 3 days. These parks as healing places, these parks as to historic places, these parks as places of First Amendment expression. I think the Friends Group issue that we've just talked about is also one that's on the table and very important. And Kevin Driscoll, who got up and spoke just a minute ago, is an unsung hero. Washington Park has not had a Friends Group until very recently, and they are working right now to pull together a core of people to create a Friends Group for this park. And so I think not only is that exciting in terms of the development of that Friends Group, but then the broader question of how we have these Friends Groups working together. And in Seattle, for example, there is a group for all the Olmsted parks. There's an umbrella group that brings the various parks together. Other cities, you find you've got Friends Groups for each discrete park. And I think that's something, again, the Olmsted Network would like very much to be working with the community about. Maybe there's a broader way to think about these parks than just the discrete and individual ones. So I just want to say a thank you to all of you for really giving us much food for thought. We're going to take a brief break. We're going to be bringing in Patricia O'Donnell as our next speaker. She is a national expert who is particularly thoughtful in terms of how do we take these historic parks and adapt them to current needs. That was obviously a leitmotif of many of the questions that we've just heard. Are these places carved in alabaster? The answer is no, but there are good ways to adapt them and there are bad ways to adapt them if you want to retain their soul. And so that's what we're going to hear about in the next presentation. So we'll take a few minutes for a break and we'll call you back in a few minutes.